I'd like to welcome White House Trade Policy Director Peter Navarro. Peter, thank you for joining me this morning.
Always a pleasure to talk with you, Rick.
All right, I guess the easiest question is, when you and your boss, President Donald Trump, look at the way the stock markets around the globe, and specifically the U.S. stock market's been behaving really since October, all three indices now doing better than many of their counterparts, but down on the year, what do you see is the order of culprits that are giving us this volatility and questioning what had been the recovery in a solid stock market backed up by a solid economy?
Well, I don't know if you'd call it a culprit, but I think the predominant factor, hands down, and at the top of the list, is Federal Reserve policy. Donald Trump's instincts are always right on this, and months ago, he started pointing out that the Fed was going too far too fast. And the problem is, as an excellent op-ed in today's Wall Street Journal notes, you've got a pincer movement that the Fed's engaged in with this quantitative tightening at the same time it's raising interest rates. And it's perplexing here at the White House to see this, because what we have is a tremendously booming economy, but it's driven, Rick, by three supply-side positive shocks which push inflation down. So you have these tax cuts, which are encouraging investment and productivity. You have the unleashing of our energy sector, which is making us the envy of the world in terms of that. You have this deregulation movement that Mick Mulvaney has been doing. All of those things have led us to a world where right now we have zero inflation for all practical purposes. So on Wednesday, the only argument I'm hearing for the Fed to raise rates now is that somehow they have to exert their independence from the White House. Now, this is a bad argument. I think what the Fed should do is simply do what it says it's going to do, which is look at the data. It's moved to data dependence. That's a really critical move, rather than just making, say, they're going to raise rates three times in the next year. That was crazy. Look at the data, and if the data, if they
now,
just
Peter,
look at the data.
Peter, let me stop you a minute. Yeah. Let me stop you a minute. I completely agree, and I think most market participants would agree. Certainly Mr. Warsh and Mr. Druckenmiller this morning with Fed tightening not now agree. But the issue is Jay Powell is new to the job, and many think that he will make the necessary turns and pauses. Many believe that the president's dialogue really wasn't to his benefit. Now, having said that, and yes, lots of volatility regarding the Fed, there's also a Washington Post article out that says it's not a trade war, it's a tech war. And I do think that if you're in an industrial company or any major company that's looking to increase, spend capital, try to add more to the bottom line, more production, they all have to put some of that on hold as we try to navigate what the big trade policy is going to be. And not even trade so much as IT and tech information specifically. Speak to that.
Rick, we're at a historic place that President Donald J. Trump has had the courage to bring us to, which is to say that for years, more than a decade, China has been stealing the intellectual property and technologies of the world. In the short run, this has been beneficial for some tech companies that go over to China. But over the longer term, if the price of entering the Chinese market is to surrender your technology, that's a fool's game. It's bad for the global economy. It's bad for the balance sheets of these tech companies. So President Trump has taken a stand on this. We have negotiations with the Chinese that there's much talk about. What I would urge people to do on Wall Street is, rather than follow this day to day and get all excited and go up and down on rumors, is to let the process take its course. We have two of the best negotiators in the world on our side, President Trump and Robert Lighthizer, the U.S. Trade Representative. What we need, Rick, in addition to selling them more things, which is fine, there's nothing wrong with that, what we really know is need these structural reforms, which will protect the technology crown jewels of America and the world. Because, Rick, it's not just the U.S. that's the victim here. It's Europe, it's Japan, it's countries around the world that innovate and then find those innovations winding up in China in counterfeit and pirated goods. So these are big stakes.
You know, but, Peter, yeah. Peter, once again, I think that many would say it's been a messy process. Many believe they weren't sure exactly what the president was after. but they all agree with your last several statements. So I guess one worry I hear is that retaliatory tariffs kind of in remission. You know, there's going to be some progress on autos, some buying of commodities. Many traders are a little nervous that those will be put on an equal field what's going on with tech and technology and tech information. Could you speak to the notion that the president understands those are all important, but those are handfuls of billions versus the big picture, which is handfuls and handfuls of trillions with a T?
That's exactly right, Rick. I mean, there's two issues. One is the market access to the Chinese market, and there's also the purchases of our goods. But the bigger issue long term for the global economy, for this economy, is who basically is going to lead the technology space. And it's artificial intelligence, it's blockchain technology, it's advanced manufacturing, it's robotics, it's new energy vehicles. And the problem we face as a world with China is that China has targeted all of those sectors and uses all its mercantilist and protectionist tools to advance its agenda at the expense of everybody else. So again, traders here, if you're trying to trade this between now and March 1st, that's a fool's game. The only person who's going to make money on that is the short sellers on false rumors. What we need to do is calmly look at the chessboard and understand two things. First of all, this trade dispute with China has a very small impact on the U.S. economy. The billions that are discussed are a small
fraction. I agree with you there. But capital spending is one of these things, whether it was the repatriation kind of tied up with the tax reform we did, capital spending has been stubbornly unresponsive. And many, many CEOs come on our channel, Peter, and they're with you. But they know this is long term. What do you tell a CEO of an industrial company looking to understand global supply chains, and how does he invest in the future with such big unknowns? Your final thoughts, sir.
Sure. My final thoughts here, if you're going to invest inside our borders. That's where the action is. That's where the markets are. That's where the innovation is. That's where we need to be. I'm all for a global supply chain. But a lot of that needs to come back home as well, both for economic security and national security purposes. And we've seen the beauty of the Trump trade policy is we've seen investment reshore here. So any investor should have faith in Trumpnomics, which is basically deregulation, tax cuts, unleashing the energy sector, and sound trade policies.
Now, what about specifically investment in specifically investment in China? I understand build it here, I get that. But there's going to be many circumstances, like some of the aftermarkets, like Boeing today in the Wall Street Journal. There's certain finishing touches they like to do there in China. What about investing in China? Any final thought on that investment via the U.S. and others?
Rick, I think that question underlines the stakes involved here. If we can get to a place where American companies can be in China without losing their intellectual property and technology and sell into that market, that would be a beautiful place to be. It's going to be a very hard place to get to, and that's why you have to put your faith here, President Trump and Robert Lighthizer. But either way, whatever happens, this president is going to have policies that grow this economy and defend this country. And people should be very bullish about that. And that's why, you know, last word is that the reason why the Fed shouldn't raise interest rates on Wednesday is not because the economy's slowing down, it's because the economy's growing without inflation.
You know, Peter, thank you for your time. One thing I will tell you, traders are never calm and they never hold their breath and think, I'm going to be calm and see what holds for the future. They're a nervous bunch. Yeah. Thank you for your time and thoughts.
How they lose money, Rick, being too nervous.
I understand. Thank you.